your attention up front. Please do continue to enjoy your meals. And thank you to all the wait staff. It was absolutely fantastic. It's my pleasure to introduce our first speaker of our conference. Dr. Mark Skousen is a nationally known investment expert, economist, university professor, and author of more than 25 books. Currently, Dr. Skousen is a presidential fellow at Chapman University. He recently was named one of the 20 most influential living economists. He earned his PhD in monetary economics at the George Washington University. He has taught economics and finance at Columbia Business School, Columbia University, Mercy College, Chapman University, and others. He has also been a consultant to IBM, Hutchinson Technology, and other Fortune 500 companies. Since 1980, Dr. Skousen has been editor-in-chief of Forecasts and Strategies, a popular award-winning investment newsletter. In 1995, he served as editor of the investment series Secrets of the Great Investors. He is a former analyst for the Central Intelligence Agency, a columnist to Forbes magazine, and past president of the Foundation for Economic Education. He has written articles for the Wall Street Journal, Liberty, Reason, Human Events, The Daily Caller, and more. In honor of his work in economics, finance, and management, Grantham University renamed its business school the Mark Skousen School of Business. Dr. Skousen has lived in 8 nations and traveled and lectured throughout the United States and 70 countries. He grew up in Portland, Oregon. He and his wife, Joanne, and 5 children have lived all over, and he is here joining us now. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Mark Skousen.
Thank you, Julia. Thank you. Well, it's a delight to be here. I came over from New York City. I know there are some people here from New York. The Empire State. And it's just a pleasure to be here to talk about Young America's Foundation. I was part of the original YAF, which is Young Americans for Freedom. And that was back in the 60s. So I'm aging myself a little bit. In fact, this summer I attended my 50th high school reunion. And my biggest fear was that someone, I'm probably the only one who's graduated from Sunset High School in Portland, Oregon that has a Wikipedia page. So I figured some people were gonna come up and say, do you remember me? I mean, you know, 50 years, I'm supposed to remember someone, but sure enough, the very first person who was about 6'5" came up to me and looked down at me and said, Mark Skousen, do you remember me? And I said, Phil Donaldson, you're darn tootin', I remember you. And the only reason I remember him is because he was my best friend growing up, and he still looked the same 50 years later. Pretty impressive. So I'm delighted to be the first speaker at this conference because I have been the final speaker at conferences. And in fact, I'll tell you my favorite final speech story, which is the reason why I don't like to be the final speaker. In 1980, I spoke at the New York Money Show at the Hilton Hotel. On the second floor, the Hilton Hotel ballroom holds 2,000 people, and every seat was filled for the final session of a conference that had gone on for 3 days. And the final session, Saturday afternoon, began with Henry Kissinger, the Secretary of State, who also helped open up China back in the 70s, for those of you who don't remember, which is probably pretty much everybody here. But anyway, Henry Kissinger was a very big name, and it was packed, and they listened for 2 full hours as Henry Kissinger pontificated and answered questions. And when he finished, Harry Brown was the next speaker. Now, you probably don't remember Harry Brown, but Harry Brown had, at the time, the number one bestseller on the New York Times bestseller list, How to Profit from a Monetary Crisis. He later ran for president of the United States on the Libertarian Party ticket 2 times in a row. Very famous person. And half the audience, when Harry Brown got up to speak, half the audience got up and walked out on him, because he was nowhere near as famous as Henry Kissinger. So Harry Brown spoke for an hour, and everybody listened to what he had to say, the half that were there. And then after he left, the final speaker was announced, Mark Skousen, me. And ladies and gentlemen, students, the entire rest of the audience got up and proceeded to exit as I was giving a speech. So I realized at that point, either I had to improve my speaking skills or never be the final speaker at an event. And so I'm delighted that I was asked to give the talk today to you as students, to get you excited about Ronald Reagan and conservative values, as many of you mentioned. Now, I knew Ronald Reagan. I met Ronald Reagan a number of times. And to give you the right background on that, Ronald Reagan, before he was president, we had Jimmy Carter. And Jimmy Carter's, I had a White House press pass at the time. I was living in Washington, D.C., and I went to the White House press meetings with the president. Jimmy Carter was my first experience, and it was total chaos. They'd jump up and down and say, Mr. President, Mr. President, Mr. President, and they'd all be yelling at the same time. And Jimmy Carter gave so many press conferences that people stopped showing up. And so half the seats would be empty. But I noticed right before the press conference began, suddenly they were all completely full. And what happened was Jimmy Carter had had his staff members coming in and filling in to make it look like there was a full crowd. It was total chaos. Well, when Ronald Reagan was elected president, and along with that, Nancy Reagan, who was really the secret behind the success of Ronald Reagan when it came to organizing, and she said, we're changing the rules now at the press conferences. From now on, no one can stand up and yell, Mr. President. Everyone simply raises their hand, and you will be called upon by the president. And so I, with a lot of other press, couldn't wait for the Ronald Reagan press conference. And I was there for one of the very first ones. And you had rows of White House press asking questions. You had the first row, the second row, the third row, and fourth row. And I was on the third row. And Reagan pointed to the person on the first row and said, your question. Person asked the question and the president answered. Then he went to the second row, pointed to the person right above the other person on the second row, and said, what is your question? Person asked the question, Ronald Reagan answered it. And then he pointed to the person on the third row, and that was me. He pointed right at me and he said, what is your question? And I didn't have one. I was there just to enjoy the moment. And I'll never forget missing the opportunity to be on nationwide TV to ask the President of the United States a question and didn't have anything to say. I was unprepared. But students, it taught me a very important lesson in life, and that was to be prepared to take advantage of the situation. And I never forgot that. So in 1996, I was at an investment conference at the Del Coronado Hotel in San Diego. Anybody know about this hotel? It is known as the President's Hotel. And it happened to be, I was there on the night of the last presidential debate between Bill Clinton and Robert Dole. And the very next morning, I decided to go out and jog on the beach. And as I was about to prepare to jog on the beach, there was suddenly several Secret Service agents, and they looked at me and they said, stand back, and out walked Bill Clinton, President of the United States. And he waved and then proceeded to run down the beach jogging with these four or five Secret Service agents. Well, I said, this is interesting. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to jog behind the president and wait for him to turn around and come back. And when he does, I'm going to go up and say hello, and I'm going to jog with the President of the United States. And so the president started running up there, ran a couple of miles. I stayed behind, and sure enough, turned around and started jogging back. And as he did, I was jogging toward him. I went out, reached my hand, and said, Mr. President, you mind if I jog with you? And he said, that would be great. I turned around, and for half an hour, I jogged with Bill Clinton, the President of the United States. And you know what I discovered in talking to him? I didn't know this, Andrew and Pat. Bill Clinton is a conservative Republican. And if you're wondering, what does that mean? He is a politician. He recognized what my interests were, and he adjusted accordingly. Man was very impressive. So after half an hour, I had in my pocket a $1 bill, and I pulled out a $1 bill, because I always keep a dollar bill in case I want to buy a drink or something like that. I pulled out a dollar bill, and I said, listen, Mr. President, could you sign this dollar bill? I'd really like to prove to my wife that I jogged with the President of the United States. And the White House was there. They took pictures of us and so forth, and he handed the President a pen, and he was signing it, this dollar bill, in his left hand. And right before he signed it, he looked at me, and he says, it's illegal, but I'll do it anyway. And so that seems to be the case with Bill Clinton. But anyway, his mantra. But that lesson I learned from Ronald Reagan was an important thing, to take advantage of the situation when you can. So I think that's a very important lesson for you to learn in life, to take advantage when the situation arises, if you're properly prepared. Now, Ronald Reagan signed some legislation which I think, from my mind as a financial writer, I've been writing an investment newsletter for 36 years. My newsletter started publication the month that Ronald Reagan was elected President of the United States. So that was a fortuitous event. And so for 36 years, I've been writing my monthly newsletter, and now I do a hotline and so forth. I brought a couple copies of my newsletter. We'll have it in the back if any of you are interested in finance. If you want a guaranteed job, guaranteed that you will never be unemployed, go into finance. That's where the money is. Finance, economics, investments. And I would add engineering. You'll never not lose a job with engineering. And maybe medicine. That's a fantastic field at all. But you history majors, you English majors, you lawyers, your future lawyers, there is no guarantee. I give a whole talk on jobs, but mainly to college students. If you're going on to college, you don't have to, you can postpone that decision. Although I would highly recommend, we'll talk a little bit about that with the A&W principle. But before I do so, I want to mention that Ronald Reagan's favorite piece of legislation, from my concern, he signed some legislation called the American Eagle Gold and Silver Act of 1985. And it created these. This is a silver dollar. And it's legal tender, equal to a dollar. So it's legal tender equal to the dollar bill that all of you as students perhaps have in your pocket. Maybe a lot of you have debit or credit cards, and that's about it. Does any of you still carry around a dollar bill? Anybody have a dollar bill? Okay, pull out a dollar bill and hand it to me. And we'll make a little comparison here. Well, thank you very much. What's your name?
Joe Ballard.
Joe?
Yeah.
All right, Joe, thank you very much. That's a very clean, very nice dollar bill. That's very nice. So these are both legal tender. So you're learning something already at this conference. How many of you knew that the United States government issues two legal tender dollar bills? The $1 bill, which is paper money that you're all used to, and the silver dollar, which is legal tender, and it says $1 on it, one silver dollar. How many of you, you've all seen these, obviously, but how many of you have ever seen an American Eagle silver dollar? That's pretty surprising. I'd say about half of you. When I show this to investors at conferences, about maybe a handful have raised their hand. when I showed this to Alan Greenspan, chairman of the Federal Reserve, he said he'd never seen one before. When I showed it to Larry Summers, the Secretary of Treasury that mints these coins, he had never seen one of these things before. And 40 million of these were minted last year. Now, these two dollars were of equal value in 1960. They were both equal to a dollar. What has happened since 1960 for over 50 years? The dollar has lost 95% of its value, and the silver dollar now costs about $17 to purchase, and in real terms is worth 2 to 3 times its value of 1960. So this has been a great inflation hedge, and a lot of reasons investors buy these, and it's so tragic. They're beautiful coins. They have Lady Liberty on it. They've got the rising sun. They've got In God We Trust. They've got the eagle on the back, E Pluribus Unum. It has all of these symbols of greatness of America that the Pledge of Allegiance talks about. All are in this coin, and yet 40 million of these were minted and put in a safety deposit box, totally dark. They might as well be rounds, but they have, it's tragic. It's tragic what has happened to our money. I give a talk, and sometime I might be able to do this at another talk. What has the government done to our money? And they've eliminated these. It's called Gresham's Law. Gresham's Law says bad money drives out good. So what's the bad money? What's the good money? The good money you put in your pocket, you put it in a safety deposit box. You don't spend it. The bad money you spend, you get rid of it. All right, and it's lost 95% of its value. Ludwig von Mises, the famous Austrian free market economist, said, government is the only agency that can take a valuable commodity like paper and make it totally worthless. This isn't worth the paper it's printed on. I'm liberating myself. So, Joe, you just... Joe, your dollar bill has gone. So I suppose you want your dollar back.
Yeah, I want to drive home.
There's your dollar.
Thank you.
All right. Now, what's the date on that coin?
The
2015. The year you came to YAF. So you keep that on you, it'll give you good luck in life. And maybe if Young America's Foundation gets a nice donor put in, maybe every one of you could get a silver dollar as a symbol of coming to this conference. And make you remember what you have learned here. Now today we're going to talk about the A&W principle. All right, you're all underage, so we're using A&W. It's beer, but it's root beer, right? Root beer, no alcohol. And I want to talk about the A&W principle. This is a principle of economics that is extremely powerful in your personal life as well as the public life. So I want to talk about this, the A&W principle. Now, how many of you are taking notes so far of what anything I've said? I see a couple of A students here. When I taught at Columbia, all my A students were on the front row, and they all took notes. It's a sign of a good student. All right, so you can remember right now the A&W principle. Who said, but let's see how much you can remember of what I have just talked about. All right, so what president of the United States signed into law the American Eagle Gold and Silver Act? Very good, Ronald Reagan. And who said government is the only agency that can take a valuable commodity like paper, slap some ink on it, and make it totally worthless? Some French guy. Who said that? Mises, Ludwig von Mises, M-I-S-E-S. I should put out my textbook here, in case any of you are interested. free market textbook. This is used, by the way, in colleges as well as a lot of homeschoolers. If you want a free market textbook, no compromise, college level free market textbook, then my textbook is the answer for that, called Economic Logic. So let's talk about the A&W principle. The A&W principle. What is that all involved? Okay, so let's see. Now I need to go back. Does this go back at all? Just forward? There we go. No, I need to. Okay, there we go. So A and W. So A is the accountability principle. What do we mean by that? It's also known as the benefit principle. It's also known as the user pay principle. And the idea is those who benefit pay. That's the basic economic concept. Those who benefit, those who use something pay for it. Now in this second example, so how much, who knows the answer to this question? How much does a loaf of bread cost? Has anybody bought a loaf of bread recently and used your own money to purchase it? How much is a loaf of bread? Who would like to guess here? How much is a loaf of bread? You're not sure.
That's right.
$3.29. I mean, when I was a youngster, it was a buck, you know, a dollar for a loaf of bread. Now it's over $3. Now, why did you know that?
Because
you just bought something, but not just that you bought it, but you paid with your own money. And she was shopping around. Now, why would she be shopping around? Because it's coming out of her own pocket. Mm-hmm. All right? So bread is an example, but there's all kinds of products. Most of the time when you go into a grocery store, you pay for what you're getting. Now, suppose someone else is paying for that bread, for the drinks, and so forth. Suppose you are given a credit card from your parents or a debit card, and it's unlimited. How many of you shop around then and check the prices? Or do you just go into a 7-Eleven and just buy whatever you want and you don't even think about the price? See the difference? You can see the importance of the accountability principle. You can see why it's called accountability, because it forces you to be accountable and to shop around. And I mention here the benefits of a user pay accountability concept. You're cost conscious and shop around for best deals for quality and for variety, because you're looking at the various prices. You minimize waste and inefficiency in this system because you're being cost conscious. Rationing. Economics is all about the rationing of products according to their value. When you put a price on it, you know what the value is, you see. Bread is relatively cheap. But if you want to buy a television, how much is a television? Anybody want to know what a color TV, big screen television costs today? Pat, how much does a big screen television cost today?
1080p or 720.
You see, we know the prices. You know the prices. All right? So you value that product and it avoids shortages and surpluses. And we're going to talk a little bit about that too. Example of user pay systems: grocery stores, department stores, gasoline stations, and so forth. When you fill up with gas, how much is gasoline now in California or Vermont or Texas or Missouri? All right, how much is gas in Missouri? Somebody say $1.50. $2.84. $2.49. $1.92. Where's that? How much is it in at the School of the Ozarks? How much? See, now, why do you know that price? Why do you know that price? Because you're paying out of your own pocket, or even with a credit card, you know you're going to have to pay for it. So I'm going to extend this to a public policy. Gasoline taxes are part, are legitimate part of the accountability principle. Why? What do gasoline prices have to do with gasoline and with cars? All right, roads. Roads, the maintenance of the roads, where do you get the money to maintain the building of roads and the maintenance of roads? It comes from gasoline taxes. And if you drive the road more, do you pay more in gasoline taxes? So you see, that's another important point about the user pay accountability principle. If you buy one loaf of bread, you pay $3.29, but if you buy two loaves of bread, it's $6 and math. Come on, math majors, where are you? $6 and what? 58 cents? Yeah, you don't have your calculators with you right now, do you? Yeah. All right. So that's the point is, the more you use your car, the more gasoline you're going to pay for. Now, there is a problem with the Tesla and so forth, because they're not paying gasoline taxes. So they're thinking of imposing a tax on the Tesla automobile, which is a legitimate argument. You see, you would say, now that makes sense because that fits the accountability principle. If you're driving on the roads, you should pay for those roads to improve upon them and maintain them. Accountability principle. And I use also the state fishing license. If you are going fishing, you pay a fishing license. Now, where does that, what's that money used for? That money is used for to maintain the fisheries and so forth in that department. So it's, again, the user pay concept. If you use something, you pay for it. All right. Now, one time, we had a presidential candidate who said we should raise the gasoline tax by 50 cents and use it to pay down the national debt. Now, you have just been explained the accountability principle. You're on the midterm exam. And I ask you, is this a violation of the accountability principle to use a 50-cent gasoline tax to pay down the national debt? What do you say? You say it is a violation or it confirms the accountability principle. Which is it? Does it violate the accountability principle? Yes, it violates it, doesn't it? Because there's no relationship between the national debt and gasoline. The gasoline tax is used specifically to pay for roads. The national debt, is that paying for a war in Iraq? Who knows? Very important to see that connection. Who pays for your college education? Now we're getting to the real accountability here. Who pays for your college education? A, you could pay for your college education. How many are planning to go to college? All right. So you could pay for your college education. B, your parents could pay for your college education, your guardian. C, you might get scholarships and grants and have your entire education paid for by the college who have scholarships and grants. Or you might get a student loan, which is now run by the government. You're actually getting a government loan with the student loan. So the government is helping to pay for your college education. And there's already talk, if some of the Democrats have talked about forgiving that student loan. So what's your choice? This is going to be on the midterm. Who pays? According to the accountability principle, what is the correct answer? Who said B? You did? All right. Speak to me after the class, Will. Let me tell you, a study has shown that students who pay for their own college education choose their major faster, graduate sooner, and get better grades. Why? Want me to repeat those three benefits? Choose their major faster, get better grades, and graduate sooner. I graduated in 3 years, a four-year college program. I graduated in 3 years. Who paid for my college education? I did. Did I do part-time jobs? Yes, I did. When I started going to school, I had $50 to my name. Now, admittedly, I was living at home, which helped. So I didn't have to pay room and board. That was very beneficial. But I only had $50 to my name when I started college. And 3 years later, 4 years later, because I got a master's degree, in 4 years, I got a bachelor's and a master's degree in economics. And I had a job with the CIA. I had a brand new car that I bought with cash. And I had a fiance who I later married. Can you get any better than that? And I'm still married to her 42 years later. I paid for my own college education. Now, I also had some scholarships and grants. That's very important. The point, in today's world, it's unlikely that you can pay for your college education all yourself. But make an effort to pay for your college education, some of it yourself. Some of it yourself. It makes such a huge difference. My wife and I, for the last 7 years, have taught college courses to inmates at Sing Sing Penitentiary, maximum security prison. None of these inmates have had a college degree before, and it used to be free for inmates to take college courses. And you know what? They weren't interested. It didn't mean anything to them because they didn't have to pay for it. Now they have to pay for it. $10, they only have to pay $10 for each course, but it makes a huge difference when you're making only 17 cents an hour. It's a lot of money to them. And we also have a nonprofit organization called Hudson Link that works to help pay for textbooks and that sort of thing. But the point I'm trying to make is that when students have skin in the game, as the phrase is, it makes all the difference in education. So when you hear people say education should be free, a bell should ring up saying this is a violation of the accountability principle, the A part of A&W. How can government apply the accountability principle? Well, this is a great picture of Highway 91. How many have been on Highway 91 in California? All right, so Highway 91 is divided, isn't it? And there's a toll road and there is a freeway. Now, I'm showing you a picture here. Can you tell which one's the toll road and which is the freeway? All right, so the tollway has very few cars on it. Why? Because it costs money. The marginal price on a freeway is zero, except your time. And if time is important, which of the roads are you going to drive on? Time is important. Which one of these roads are you going to get on? The toll road. You're going to pay the extra amount. Now, most people aren't doing it, though, are they? Most people are in the freeway. Nice sounding name, freeway. But the problem is the freeway violates the principle of accountability because the user is not paying. Someone else is paying indirectly. So the toll road, more and more roads are being toll oriented. And it's a very powerful concept. And it's called peak pricing. So during heavy traffic hours, the price goes up on the toll road. so that the traffic is always moving, because time is really important for those who drive in the so-called Lexus lanes, as they call them. All right, so that's a good example where government is applying, and you're going to see more and more of this in your lives. More and more roads are providing some kind of a toll system and peak pricing. In Singapore, I've been to 71 countries. And Singapore is one of the few countries I've been to where there is never a traffic jam. Never. Because they have peak pricing. And they've got it all through their road system. It's really fantastic. All right, so let's take an example of a new sports stadium. So this is part of the midterm exam. You ready for this one?
Yeah.
All right. So who should pay for building a new sports stadium? You've taken this course in economics from Professor Skousen, and you have learned the accountability principle. So who should pay for building a new sports stadium? Should the owners and investors, A, B, the fans and ticket holders? Does that make sense? Should they pay? C, how about city and local citizens? It's benefiting everybody, so maybe everybody should pay for it. D, visitors and tourists. Why should we pay for the stadium? Let's have foreigners pay for the stadium. The visitors, you see, that's the idea. So we have a hotel tourist tax. And finally said, well, you know, really the state should pay for this. The federal government should pay for this. So what would be your answer? How many of you say A? Okay, how many say B? How many say C? D? E? All right, now am I going to change the question? If you were going to, let me say, if I asked you this question, what normally is the case? Normally, who pays for a new stadium? A, B, C, D, or E? The answer is A, B, C, D, and E, all of the above. Government is involved in all of these. Governor Scott Walker, Republican or Democrat?
Republican.
What state?
Wisconsin.
Wisconsin. Was running for president recently and then dropped out. But very controversial, but considered a conservative, right? A conservative. Signed arena deal handing $400 million of state money to billionaire NBA owners for the new Milwaukee Bucks arena, which is a beautiful arena, no question about it. And yes, the owners put up some money. And yes, fans are paying for tickets. But the state government and the city government is all involved issuing bonds and so forth to have them pay for it. And of course, if you're adopting the accountability principle, what is the correct answer? A and B. A and B. That is, the people who should pay for a sports arena are those who use it and the investors who are involved in it. That's the concept. Why is it violated all the time? Because of what is known as cronyism or crony capitalism. After one thing about free enterprise capitalism is that money is power. Money is power. And so you see all the time big corporations, MBA owners, going to the government and saying, look at the benefits. I'm bringing jobs in downtown Milwaukee. We need your support for it. And it's very appealing. But all kinds of economists, known as sports economists, have demonstrated that while it creates certain jobs, it takes away other jobs that could be used, that money, that is what economists call opportunity cost. And it also creates low-level jobs. It creates a lot of people who are selling trinkets and food and stuff like that, but it doesn't create technology type of jobs in general. So there's a lot of reasons why Scott Walker, as an economist, I would criticize Scott Walker for that. So let's move now to the W. So we've talked about A, now we're talking about W. And this is called the welfare principle. And this is a very powerful concept of welfare that you need to understand as those of you who are interested in conservative principles. So what is the welfare principle? The welfare principle is help those who need help. Does that sound good? How many of you would agree that it's a valuable concept, a good principle of Christian living, we could say, of the Judeo-Christian code? Help those who need help. But there's another side that's very important to the welfare principle, and that is you don't help those who don't need help. And why is that? Because if you help people who don't need help, you destroy their initiative. Then they're likely to take the hand out and not do anything for it. So it's a dangerous thing. You want to help people who need the help, but you want to make sure you're not helping those who don't need it, who can do it on their own. And here's a statement by Reverend William John Henry Bucker: you cannot help men permanently by doing for them what they could and should do for themselves. By the way, if you Google that quote, it'll come up Abraham Lincoln every time. Abraham Lincoln. And it's not him. There's all kinds of quotes on the internet that weren't by the original people. So this is the original guy. All right. So I have here a picture of, anybody recognize this famous minister? Joel Osteen, his wife Victoria, the most popular pastor, is known as a prosperity preacher today. And he's kind of the Billy Graham of today. And let's suppose that Joel Osteen gets up and says, you know, we've been passing the plate and we've used this money to help the poor and help the needy, and it's really great. But you know what? I've decided to be really generous. They call me the prosperity preacher, and I've decided to really go all out. And so I'm going to now make our welfare program of food, the food bank. Anybody now qualifies for the food bank. If you need your rent paid, come to me, I'll pay your rent. And we're going to help everybody. And we're not even going to ask what your needs are. If you want it, you get it. So next week, they don't have room in the Lakewood church to fill all the people who are now coming to his church. And so he has to open up bigger churches. And it's fantastic until a month later, Joel Osteen gets up and gives a new sermon. And the new sermon says, you know, I hate to break this to you, but we're running out of money. We need, when we pass the plate, can you please increase your donation tenfold? Because the demands on our welfare program have suddenly just skyrocketed. So can you please donate more? How many of you think that this minister's idea is a good one to make their welfare program open to everybody? It's a violation of the welfare principle, isn't it? You're helping those who need help, but you're also helping those people who don't need help. And it's overwhelming. And any organization that does that is asking for trouble. But There are government programs that do just that. Which of the following government programs violates the welfare principle? I've written it up here on the wall. Social Security and Medicare. Why does it violate the welfare principle? Now, it doesn't necessarily violate the user principle because you do pay into Social Security. How many of you have jobs? You pay Social Security? How about Medicare? You pay Medicare? You don't know, do you? Well, let me tell you something. For those of you who've been around a while, do they pay into Medicare?
Yes.
Do you pay Social Security?
Yes.
And when do you benefit from that?
Never.
That's what I said when I was my age, but now, supposedly, I haven't quite signed up for Social Security yet, but I'm coming close. All right? But Social Security and Medicare violate the welfare principle. It's helping those who need help. We all agree with that, right? If you need money for retirement, if you need money for going to the hospital, does Social Security and Medicare help? Yes, it does. But it also helps those who don't need the money. Does Bill Gates, the richest man in the world, have a Medicare card? Not yet, but when he turns 65, he will. Warren Buffett, who I met several years ago, I said, do you have a Medicare card? Yes, I do. Do you have Social Security? Yes, I do. We're paying for Warren Buffett's Social Security retirement program. We're paying for Warren Buffett's prostate cancer problem, which he had. So the surgery, he used Medicare for that. So all of you are talking about, how can I win the argument against your, what you call, liberal friends, okay? And the welfare program is a good way to answer that, because if you ask any of them, should we be paying for Bill Gates and Warren Buffett's retirement or their medical expenses, you're going to come at an agreement with them. They're going to agree with you. And everybody's going to say the same thing. And see, that's how you win an argument. You win an argument when you come to an agreement that everybody can agree on. And this is one of them. In fact, the A&W principle is something that everybody can agree on, the concept of user pay. And then the idea of the welfare program, you help those who need help. You're going to get all of those liberal friends on your side when you say that. Everybody is going to come to an agreement. But then when you add the other side of the coin, which is really valuable, it's a gotcha moment. Should we be paying for people who don't really need it? And the answer is, and everybody pretty much agrees, it's not the case. Now, here is ones that do not violate the program, the welfare program, because, by the way, food stamps is now called SNAP. Food stamps is like a SNAP. You can get it really easy, but they still have a means test. To qualify for food stamps, and I'm sorry, it says Medicare there, but it should say Medicaid. To qualify for food stamps and Medicaid, not Medicare, Medicaid, you must not earn more than $31,536 a year. Now, they've been making it more and more generous. But the fact is that no one in this room, well, we could ask, how many of you, well, there are several people here who, is there anyone here who's on Medicare or Social Security? All right. So you're probably 65 or above, right? Is there anyone else here who's willing to do that? All right, willing to say? I speak to a lot of investment groups, and I can get a third or half of them raising their hand, because a lot of investors are older and retirees and so forth. And I'll say, by show of hands, how many of you are on Social Security and Medicare? About half the hands will go up. And I'll say, and how many of you have a Medicare card? And the hands will stay up. And then I say, okay, and how many of you are on food stamps? And it's really fun to watch, because you know what happens? Every hand goes down. So every hand is up on Social Security and Medicare. And then I said, how many of you are on food stamps or Medicaid? And all the hands go down. And I said, why is that? And the answer is the welfare principle, means testing. Because you have to have a certain, or you, if you earn too much money, you don't qualify for food stamps and Medicaid. So there's a means test. So the welfare principle is confirmed with food stamps and Medicaid. Now, they've made food stamps and Medicaid too easy now, in my opinion. And in fact, you can see on this chart, food stamp spending and enrollment is rising rather dramatically as a result of the primarily the 2008 crisis. But I don't have a pointer here, but do you see this period right here? Around 1995 all the way to 2001, that drop off right there. Why did that happen? Because of the Welfare Reform Act. That was one of the best pieces of legislation that Bill Clinton signed with support of the Republicans who were in power on the Hill at that time. They worked together. And they came up with the Welfare Reform Act. And part of the Welfare Reform Act was to say, after 5 years, if you're able-bodied, you no longer qualify for food stamps and Medicaid. You got to go out and get a job. And that was a very powerful incentive. And that's why the food stamp program and Medicaid actually had a significant drop. And then, of course, George W. Bush came in, who was the compassionate conservative. And of course, the result was a and then it ended his last year in office. You had a financial crisis that brought about the Great Recession, and food stamps continued to rise to the point where 50 million Americans are now on food stamps. So it's probably too generous right now, but it would be, as I told my investor friends, every one of you would have food stamps in your pocket today, except that there's a means test that keeps you from getting it. Otherwise, you'd all be on food stamps. So fortunately, in 1965, Lyndon Baines Johnson, when he pushed through the Great Society programs of Medicare, and then he introduced Medicaid and food stamps, he required a means test. If we didn't have a means test, we'd have really severe problems in our country. So, great quote from those of you who like Donald Trump. He spoke at our conference at Freedom Fest this year. Food stamps should be temporary, not a decade on the dole. So I think that's a very important lesson. And again, this is something that most people can agree with. Do you want a permanent class of welfare people? Nobody wants that. If your arguments, you can win your arguments if you start with premises that we can all agree on. And nobody wants someone to be on welfare their entire lives. Nobody wants 2, 3, and 4 generation people on welfare. We can all agree on that, you see. That's a powerful argument for your conservative case. And especially if you can make it personal. Now, my wife and I, involved in our church, we deal with people in Yonkers all the time. And Yonkers is minorities, largely. They are financially, they are mainly on welfare. We deal with a lot of women out of wedlock, not married, having children. There's all kinds of problems, drug problems, crime problems in Yonkers. And you can't tell me you can't find any of your so-called bleeding heart liberals who will reach out there and say, you know, that's a good situation. We want to continue that going on. No, they all recognize that at Yonkers and other poverty-stricken areas of the country, you want to get rid of the drugs, you want to get rid of the crime, you want to get rid of the out-of-wedlock marriages, and you don't want people on Section 8 housing and on food stamps and Medicaid and so forth. Nobody wants that. And in fact, my experience and my wife's experience with people who are on the dole, they don't like it either. But you know what? They're stuck. They're stuck. Because if they find a job and they're offered jobs from time to time, they seriously wonder, should I take this job? And why are they so afraid of this job? And it's a secure job and it's paying more than the minimum wage and they can get off of welfare. But here's the problem. If you get off of welfare, try to get back on Section 8 housing that has a 3-year waiting list. Then you think twice whether you want to do that or not. So there's a lot of issues here where you can really make your case by using the A&W principle. Here's a quote from another speaker at our Freedom Fest conference, Senator Mark Rubio, great senator from Florida. Our current government programs offer at best only a partial solution. They help people deal with poverty, but they do not help them escape it. See, and again, these are statements that everybody can agree with. And that's what you want to start with. If you start arguments with people where you have fundamental differences, you're not going to win. You're not going to win the argument. You can only win it by focusing on what you can start and agree with, right? So here we go, Senator Bernie Sanders, self-proclaimed socialist. Healthcare should be universal and free of charge. Violates what principle?
Accountability.
All education, including college education, should be free and the wealthy should pay for it. Now, we haven't talked about, we could talk about taxes and how you deal with that issue. There's a lot of stuff that really requires economic principles and so forth that we could talk about further. But again, my message to you, young people, is to if you want to win arguments, start with things that you can agree with. And the A&W principle is a great way to do it. And to do this properly so that you'll remember the A&W principle, we're now going to pass out A&W root beer to everybody, and we're going to do a toast.
All right.
So do we have the A&W? Here we go. Okay, so we're passing this around to everybody. And you can fill your glass, or you can just pop open the can and drink from the can, and we are going to stand, and we are going to give a toast to the A&W principle. Let me have one of those. Great, thank you. Oh, nice and cold. Great. All right, just pop this open. I wonder what A&W actually stands for. Does anybody know?
I'll look it up right now.
Oh, good. He's going to look it up. It'll probably say accountability and welfare. Does it say on the back, Pat? Nothing? First initials of the brewery? Oh, people who created it. Yeah. All right. Does everybody have... we're going to answer questions after the toast. So if everybody, does everybody have one now? Okay, everybody stand up. Yeah, I wish to propose a toast in honor of the A&W to Ronald Reagan and conservative values. Hear, hear. Oh, boy, that hit the spot. Well, that was great. And I think with that, then, Pat, we're going to take questions.
Q&A, yep.
Q&A, and we have a microphone. This young lady over here is dying to ask a question. After she's imbibed in a little A&W here.
Actually, sir, I did not imbibe in the A&W, and neither did our table. We actually didn't because we thought it was kind of a violation on the accountability.
Oh, because it was free.
It was.
Very good point. So, Pat, how much did the, or Jolia, how much did these cost? Maybe less than a dollar each, right?
I'll be collecting those.
All right, so from this table, we want a dollar for each one of you. And once you've paid for it, then you can stand up and propose a toast. Does that sound good?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's have the dollars. You want to go over there?
We never, you know, like, said that we were going to do that.
That's true. It's totally voluntary. That's totally voluntary.
So she can take him back.
Yes, so. That's true. And in fact, we could also suggest that, let me just say by a show of hands, how many of you would have been willing to pay the $500? How much would it cost? What's their cost, Pat, to run a show like this? A lot,
yeah,
right?
$1,400.
Per person.
Now, how many of you paid $1,400? And how many of you would be willing to pay $1,400 to come here? So, There are situations where you are being subsidized. Now, you are spending your time, and your time is valuable. You're willing to do that. And so you are sacrificing, you are benefiting, you are using some of your time to come here. So you have that in that respect. But there's no question you're not paying the full price, as you're not paying the full price for this. So there are examples, and we mentioned examples. Imagine if the new sports stadium, by the way, the AT&T sports stadium, I think I had a picture up here, the AT&T sports stadium, that one actually was completely financed privately. Completely financed privately, but it was highly exceptional. In most cases, is you're paying some of it while others are being subsidized and so forth. But the key is you're paying something. That's really important.
Hi. And there we go. My name is Joe Ballard, and I'm from San Jose, California. My question is this. Every time you talk about cutting, anytime as a conservative I try to talk about cutting Social Security and benefits, liberals love to jump to the moral argument that we have a moral obligation to help people. And while I do think it's true, how can you argue this without sounding like a cutthroat capitalist that is completely doesn't care about the poor?
Well, I have found that the best solution is to find alternatives. In other words, just answering no, we're not going to subsidize or not going to help somebody, that's not a good solution. But if you can find alternatives, for example, NGOs. How many know what an NGO is? Okay, what's an NGO?
Non-government organization.
NGOs, charitable organizations, foundations, nonprofits. Larry King, who was on CNN for many years, he's been off the air now for 4 or 5 years, so you may not recognize that name. But Larry King talked a lot about how he had a heart attack in the 80s and how he almost died. And he, as a result of that, created a foundation to help people, to raise money, and to help people deal with heart disease. And
It's a nonprofit organization. And annually, he has a big event where he invites celebrities and they play music and they do all kinds of things and they raise millions of dollars for this great, important mission of helping people to overcome heart disease. And multiply that by all kinds of examples of where you can help people out. And there's lots of nonprofit organizations that are fighting cancer. And look at the Bill Gates Foundation and other foundations that are out there doing really good works that your liberal friends seem to really support. Okay? The key is you're providing an alternative, you see, and it's a more valuable alternative. And in fact, Larry King waxed eloquently about he would bring in stories of people who were helped by this foundation to overcome heart disease. And then, not realizing what he was saying was, he said, you know, it's so tragic that the government's not doing this. And he didn't realize that the great thing about this nonprofit organization is that without that nonprofit organization and with the government doing it, people wouldn't really care. They wouldn't really care. But when you have a nonprofit and you're bringing together all these celebrities and they're singing and they're hearing these stories and so on, and they're sob stories, and you realize that there's a passion about this that would not exist when it's a government program. If you want a government program that is destructive, look at the welfare system. And look at the third and fourth generation of people that are on welfare, because they just get a check and nobody cares. But you talk to people that are involved with the food banks. If you want to have a good experience, go visit a food bank, which is all privately funded. It's all voluntary. And you see in the eyes the people who get the help they need on food, not the food stamps, but from these food banks where people are in need of assistance, and you hear their story and you feel for their lives, this is where you succeed. And by the way, this is really important that you participate in these things, that you are involved with your church or your local community and you help out in these charitable organizations. Let me give you an example. Hurricane Sandy, which occurred, there's several people here from New York, up maybe upstate New York, but down where we were in near New York City, Hurricane Sandy 2 years ago decimated many parts of New York. Well, I was involved with my local church, went twice to fix up homes and clean out their basements that had been water everywhere. And these people, when they saw us coming, they were so grateful. And you know what they said about the government? They said the government did only one thing. They came by and would pick up the garbage that we volunteers put out on the front. They did nothing other than pick up the garbage. But meanwhile, you had the Lions clubs, you had local clubs providing food and so forth, and we were wearing special orange shirts and people saw us and they thanked us. They thanked those who had volunteered to go out and help. And that's the greatness of America. That's the greatness of conservatism, is when you volunteer and participate in these kinds of activities. That's what you need to do, and that's the answer to your so-called liberal friends who are not liberal when it comes to helping out with charitable causes and so forth. I mean, some are, believe me. I've met a number of my friends who are big pro-government types and so on, and they do volunteer their time. So if you join in with them, you're going to have an impact on their lives when they see that you've volunteered to participate in that.
Hello, my name is Abraham Martin from School of the Ozarks in Missouri. As I was listening to your lecture, I noticed the the similarities between the two components, the accountability and the welfare, almost in the same way that we have the problems with in the accountability we have, prices are inflated for items. I thought a brilliant example was the gas. And conversely, in the welfare, we have people who are living in poverty. Is there already a system, or would a system be practical for, almost like the food stamps or Medicaid, for different markets of gas was a brilliant example. For example, that gas, if prices were too high in one region and not high enough in another region, is there a system that could be used to balance that out without disrupting the accountability and welfare principles that we talked about?
Yeah, so I think the answer to that is, well, you let the market perform. You don't want to engage in any kind of price controls. And the only reason that prices are not the same everywhere, some of you said gasoline prices were under $2 in Texas and they're higher in here in California, they're higher in New York, they're slightly higher. And often it's the difference in tax levels. Some taxes, some state taxes are higher than others. And they're not all used for roads. They're used for other purposes. Just like real estate taxes are not used for the upkeep of real estate, they're often used for public education programs. So you're going to have that normal disparity in transportation also, because oil and gas are produced in Texas, but not in New York City, for example. So that's another reason that prices vary in that regard. But if you want to help people and still maintain choice so they can use that money for whatever purpose, Milton Friedman had a great idea, and other conservative free market economists have proposed a negative income tax, where basically you help those who have a lower income level. They receive a subsidy, and they can use that money for any purpose, whether it's for health care or for food or what have you, and you do that. But again, it's means testing. It's a negative income tax, so if you're not paying any taxes, you get a subsidy. And it's much more efficient, too, because you don't have that huge bureaucracy of administrators who often go counter to the welfare, helping people out. In fact, welfare caseworkers are often a serious impediment to getting people off welfare. And we've had to deal with several welfare case workers who told the recipients on welfare, don't take that job because we can take better care of you under the welfare system. And you're going to lose your Section 8 housing and all that sort of thing. It's kind of tragic what is happening there. So I think if you went to that, that would be good. Now, ideally, you'd like to rely entirely on NGOs, on non-government and charitable organizations, and not have a welfare system at all that requires mandatory taxes and that sort of thing. That would be my ideal world. But you're not going to win any arguments with that. If you want to win the argument, you have to stick with the welfare principle. Okay, governments, we agree since the 1930s, we're going to have the government involved. So we want to reduce the harm that they do. And the best way to do that is with the negative income tax. It's with a means test on your welfare programs. That's something where we're helping. You look good in their eyes because you're helping, but you're not helping the rich fat cats, which is crony capitalism.
We have time for one more question.
Hi, I'm Adriana Maljanian, and I'm homeschooled from Altadena, California. And I have a question. How would the economics principle apply to the refugee crisis in Eastern Europe without creating millions of international dependents?
Yeah, that's a tough question. These mass migration of refugees is a very difficult it's a challenge to try to simulate those people. I think it does. I am impressed with the countries that have opened their doors to people who are genuinely hurt by what is happening. I mean, these are political refugees that could be harmed. A lot of them are Christian groups that would be killed if they weren't taken care of. But there's also just lots of people for economic reasons. They're unemployed. They're being threatened. There's chaos that's happening in Syria and other parts of Africa. And it could be explosive. It could turn into something that even is much greater, especially when we willingly just say, okay, come on in, rather than, look, you got to solve your own problems here. So I think I've painted the kind of dire situation that's at hand, and the Germans and others. I mean, I've talked to members of my own faith who are opening their doors to these people. It's not just government that's opening up buildings and say, okay, you go into these buildings and you're on welfare and that sort of thing. We're talking about Christians who are opening up their doors, their homes, and letting these people live with them for a period of time. I mean, it's quite a sacrifice. It's part of our heritage that we help people out and do this. But I would like to see it as voluntary as possible, rather than the government doing it. It's the same thing with the Hurricane Sandy that I mentioned, to have the non-government organizations involved and the charitable organizations to solve this problem. But it's just temporary. I mean, we're dealing here with a much bigger problem that gets into foreign policy and whether, you know, what is our policy? I don't know if you're having any experts coming in on foreign policy. They would be more able to answer those questions. I don't really have an answer, to be honest with you, on some of these things. So I can just speak from what I've read and my own analysis. Well, very good. I'll thank you all very much. Thank you. I'm gonna leave this textbook here, and anyone can take a look at what is being offered here. And then I have a couple of newsletters also for those who are interested. So Pat, maybe just
let's give Dr. Skousen another round of applause.
Thank you.
I know quite a few of you are tired and ready to go to bed, but our shuttles will be here in about 30 minutes to take everyone back to the hotel. But before that, I have a few announcements to make. Please remember that you've signed a responsibility pledge. We're here to have a great time, and we're so happy to have you, but we also want you to be responsible while you're here. You are to be in your rooms by 10 o'clock. That will be right when you get to the hotel, just about. And we will be conducting room checks, so please answer your door when I come knocking. I was an RA for 3 years in college, and I can bang on that door until my fingers bleed. So, and I don't want to have to do that. Some common sense reminders. Boys, you're not allowed in the ladies' rooms. Ladies, you're not allowed in the gentlemen's rooms. Just please follow that. And you are to stay on the hotel property at all times unless you're escorted by a parent or a foundation staff member. If you have any emergencies, if you need anything like that, please contact me. The hotel has my room information. Directs you to me if there is an emergency. I know several of you also have my cell phone number, so if you need anything, please call me. And then a lot of you did not provide your departure information. I know you just got here and so sad to think about leaving already, but we do, if you are flying